G'day and welcome. I'd first of all like to take this opportunity to just acknowledge the fact that this series is for those who are looking to remain impartial on things and maintain an objective approach to reality, not a subjective one. So having said that, what I'd like to say is if you are considered maybe easily offended or triggered by certain things, especially involving, profanity for one to begin with, and violence and or crime, then maybe this isn't for you. Again, we like to practice what we preach, and we talk a lot about being realists rather than idealists. So accepting the fact that, you know, reality and people will not bend to our feelings or our wants, but if we're going to consider what we need in life, when we talk about priorities to be able to get shit done, you know, objectives and priorities, we need to remain objective. I'm going to be breaking that down a lot today and in the rest of the series also. So again, welcome. Thank you for joining us. Thank you to all subscribers, followers on social media and members of the SSSA, the Street Smart Survival Academy, now available in the Get Street Smart app. As many of you have seen in the Street Smart Survival Academy, I've put out a number of new ebooks and learning materials. And in that, it actually says, you know, brought to you by the Get Street Smart podcast. And it's been a while that we've been working on this. You know, it's been, I'd say 2 years in the making. I've done a number of courses with my brother Phil. We've put together entire programs which we felt needed to be out there to the general public. It should be common knowledge, and knowledge is useless left up on the shelf like a book that's never read. So we decided to put those programs into this series for free, and again help to try and support the community really through a positive and again objective approach to the education and training in personal security, self-protection and self-reliance. Again, it's been a while in the making. It's been a couple of years, and what a couple of years it's been. This is my, I think, second or third time redoing this introduction, as before I'd gone away for the weekend, which I'm just about to get to, having spent 4 days in the bush. It was just amazing. But before that, I was stuck in a really hard place, and I think that came across in my communication. And my whole point of redoing this, of coming out with this new series and everything, is to have another crack at just positively communicating with clarity an objective approach to personal security, self-protection and self-reliance. It doesn't mean that my way is the be-all to end-all. It's just I want to share these realizations and observations based on my observations, really, and my experience, you know. So there's a lot of people out there preaching self-defense. I want to break down what the difference is between self-defense and self-protection. A proactive approach is what we're talking about here, and that starts with personal security. On the weekend, I just went away to it was a three-day camp. We were there for 4 days. We were on a hanging swamp, as they call it. So it's a swamp on the side of a hill. So where my daughter and I set up our camp, it was dry at one part, and then it just turned into slush and it was freezing. But you know, there was 30 odd people out there with us in the freezing cold and the wet for 4 days, and not one person bitched about it. Not one person. Everyone was just so happy to be there. Everyone was just on the same page. And as I put on social media, I think a day after getting back, when I was out in the bush again with Benny and DJ working on some new things, I said, I met some real motherfuckers out there, man. Some real motherfuckers, like some guys who I'm just like, wow, you know. I'm thinking to myself as I'm heading down there, it was a 13-hour drive each way, roughly, with roadworks and a couple of stops, short breaks, that sort of thing. I'm thinking, what's this going to be like, you know, because Jakey's demographic, or his audience, for lack of a better term, seems to be the more so quote-unquote hippie type that probably will find what I've got to say a little bit hard to hear. And it couldn't have been further from the truth. You know, my expectations are just a sense of entitlement, which I'll get to. That was the first thing I spoke about actually at the camp. And you know, it changed my perspective. You know, I changed my environment. I went out in the bush, and I was there for, what was it, 4 days, as I said, and didn't once look at social media. I checked an email before I started. I did my, I guess, due diligence and checked in just on work. And there was things popping up. There was all sorts of crazy stuff. And I just went, yep, I'll get to that when I get to that. This is my priority right now. And, you know, just so many profound things that I realized and observed over the weekend that reinforced my fundamental beliefs and reignited this fucking fire, this flame in me that I always had and I felt that I'd kind of lost over the last couple of years, to be honest. Because I went from, as I talk about, going to a different city every weekend, and everywhere I went, people having shit ready for me and not waiting on me to any degree, but happy to see me and couldn't wait to link up and do what we do and get at it, and just everyone on the same page, everyone positive and productive and persistent and all the rest, and being a positive influence to their three circles, their social circle, their business circle, their personal circle, their inner circles, you know, affecting those around them in a positive way because they're becoming more confident and capable. And that was the whole point of this weekend. And I hadn't taught in English for that topic live for about 2.5 years. So, you know, I'm teaching in Japanese every week to my live members. Since I haven't been able to go back, I'll get into that and I'll talk about that more for those of you who are just joining us. But, you know, it's been a massive struggle to articulate some of these things, and I have no filter a lot of the time when we are talking about crime and violence and the nightlife and scamming and all these things. I sort of adopt that mindset again, and that, I guess for lack of a better term, persona. I don't like it about myself. It can be aggressive and intimidating, definitely assertive, and that's three of the things I sort of say. Like, you've got to have the keys to be able to switch on to that and tap into that, I guess, primitive side. You know, I'll share a story later on about a lady that we had so many ladies over the weekend. We had people from all ages and all genders and all walks of life and all professions. And again, they were there for the common goal of being more confident and capable. And again, not one person bitched. And it was so, so fucking inspiring for me to see other parents, especially mums, come there, and a couple of them dragged their kids along and they fucking loved it. Absolutely loved it. Being with guys like Jake Sarah, and myself. And Jakey, I think, you know, they call me the bad influence because people end up being, I guess, a little bit more like me in terms of just letting go of that filter, being themselves and saying what they think and saying what they mean and meaning what they say. I think that's a really important thing. I believe personally that it's important to have that transparency where you, some people might call it a safe space, I don't know, but I'm not always looking for that. But when I find that, as I did over the weekend, it's just, it does make you feel safe, I guess, in an emotional way. I've heard other people who have just gone through therapy talking about that. So yeah, that's probably what it is. And just being able to speak my mind, and my mindset, skill set, and tool set is what I'm trying to share with people. So again, it's a very objective approach to things, and remaining aware. And I'm going to break down the self-awareness and spatial awareness and situational awareness for you, and how my own sort of reflections or meditation, both in a passive form of meditation and an active form of meditation, excuse me, have helped me really sort of make it this far, for lack of a better term. But again, over the weekend, you know, I was just shown this massive sense of appreciation. At the end, a lady sat down on the last day while I was cooking breakfast for my daughter over the fire. I'll never forget this. And just said, "I just want to let you know some of the things that I appreciate." And I was like, fuck, I don't know how to receive this. I've never been good at taking compliments. I've never been good at hearing good things about me, because I've always got this, as I spoke about there, the Catholics, Catholic friends in Europe talk about this guilt and shame that hangs over their head. And a lot of people on the East Coast, actually, in New York and such, who grew up with that background, talk about this guilt and shame that they live in just out of instinct. It's sort of bred into them, so to speak. And I have that from being in Japanese society for my 20s and 30s, most of my 20s and 30s, and being a byproduct of that environment, having that sense of, and I talked about this, people say that Japanese, they're such a proud race, they're full of pride. And I don't think that's a negative thing. I think that's quite misinterpreted, and I think that people have used that as hearsay and sort of just gone with that and repeated that, unfortunately. But what I think it means to me anyway is taking pride. It's a massive sense of responsibility. And again, yeah, there's social expectations that I'm going to go on about in this series, that if you don't meet, it's absolutely shameful. You know what I mean? You are lesser than the rest of society, and you're just a piece of shit, and you're uneducated, and you have no manners, and that's what everything's based on. Business, as we talk about in Japan, is very, the foundations of business are in relationships, and that's in manners and consideration for others. And yes, Japanese people are very considerate. There was a guy who I've become straight away great friends with, I would say, from this camp who helped me move my camp. And I just felt ashamed. I felt so guilty. And I'm like, I'm sorry to take you away from what you're doing and everything. He's like, he said to me, how do you feel when you give someone something like a gift or service or whatever? I'm like, good, it's fulfilling. You have a sense of purpose. And he goes, well, let me do that for you. And I was just like, fuck. You know, I still appreciate it so much and his kindness and generosity. But this is the sort of thing I'm talking about, like just that love, you know what I mean? We are coming together out of love for training and self-development and the arts and the gijutsu, which is like a skill set, you know what I mean? Like what I actually have in terms of, that could be interpreted as technology, but it's what you've developed, what skill set you actually have, what you can bring to the table, your capabilities. So for the love of seeing that positive change and or development in ourselves, for the love of that, for the love of our fucking family, for the love of ourselves and what we do, our hobbies, our everything, the conversations we have with people. So as I said, all of these people telling me how much they appreciate it throughout the days and even at the end of the days and whatever, and just them sharing with me their experience in just that mind shift, shift in mindset over that past 3 days was just such a massive, just, it not only resonates with me because they're doing it for the same reasons, but I just appreciated it so much. You know, when someone shows you that respect and gratitude, you as a human being, I guess, tend to reciprocate. And it was so humbling for me. It's just for the last couple of years sitting here and having to really dive into the matrix and get involved with more online things. And it's been a great opportunity. You know, it's been a massive, massive stress. It's been very taxing in terms of physically, mentally, emotionally, I guess. But I could sit there and bitch about all the hard work or be appreciative of the fact that I've got great staff, I've got great family, I've had people stick by me during this entire time where my assets, especially overseas, which I haven't been able to return to since the start of the pandemic, sorry for saying the P word, my assets overseas especially turned into liabilities. But again, I could sit there and focus on the things that fuck me off and the things that are negative and the things that give me a reason not to want to do things. Or like today, it's pissing down rain. It's the fifth flood warning for the year. It's only July. The supply chain's never been this vulnerable. The cost of living has never been this high. And things are just really unstable, as I said, volatile and uncertain. And I thought, what better time than now? Because if not now, then fucking when? You can probably hear the rain. Right? I thought the roof was coming off last night at home. I'm sitting there going, holy fuck. And in about an hour, I have to leave because I have to go and get a few wisdom teeth pulled out. You know, I cracked 6 teeth at the start of this wee pandy. You know, I've had to get 20 grand's worth of dental work done. But as I said, this whole weekend, I'll keep coming back to this because it's changed me for the better, you know? And as I say, yes, people got a lot out of what we did. I'm sure they did, but I got just as much as what I want to say. Again, just hearing people's stories and their having them show their gratitude and appreciation, I was just overwhelmed. I was just overwhelmed. It really, really did change my whole approach and mindset towards living in Australia. I had all but given up. I was ready to leave. I was planning my escape, so to speak. I'm like, fuck this. I am out. Just like mates in Canada, I just can't fathom, you know, the fact that I grew up in a society that here in Australia that promoted, you know, the respect of other people's beliefs and don't talk about religion, don't talk about politics, respect other people's beliefs and opinions and all those sort of things and just leave it at the door, so to speak. And it couldn't be more the opposite these days. We've flipped it on our heads and everyone's looking for a reason to sort of categorize others into whatever group they, you know, feel that they belong in and looking for just opportunities to be more divisive. And again, when positive things like the event that we just had bring us together and help us see that common ground, it's just such an amazing thing, such a wonderful thing. And again, on the way home, I was telling my daughter how lucky I feel. You know, I was like, fuck, I'm just so grateful to come across people who are like-minded, who are positive and productive and persistent and just want to fucking get at it, you know, just want to not sit around and talk about it, but be about it. As corny as that sounds, it's fucking true. And I needed to take a page out of my own book and say, you know what, cunt, just get on with it. For fuck's sake, get on with it. As I said, I'd tried this introduction a couple of times. I was probably way too baked when I was doing it. And I just wasn't feeling it. I was doing it out of necessity. I'm like, you know, we need to put this out because we've got collectively over 300,000 subscribers on YouTube alone. We'd had, last time I checked, I think was when the Pandy first started, over 120 million YouTube views. Half of those are in Japanese. I think 157K subscribers on the Japanese channel at this point. And I haven't done a podcast in Japanese in a couple of years. I've been too busy rebuilding not just the app, but our whole entire online learning center, which we did from 2009. I started in 2009. Every cunt out there is putting shit on it, going, oh, you can't fucking do that, and distance learning doesn't work and all this. Well, it did. It fucking well did. You know, I developed, thanks for that, I developed just under 100 branches. I think it was 96 or 97 with 20-odd locations in Japan. And some of them open to the public, a lot of them not, because we work with a lot of law enforcement, military, and other national security types, which I'm going to go on to and talk about a lot. Also, my experiences in the nightlife and such. But I could sit there and think about all of the negative attitudes or the bad habits or the mindset that, especially towards people that I've gotten from that experience, or appreciate the fact that I can help share these revelations, would you call them, realizations and observations with people, and try and educate them about crime and violence and how to avoid and prevent becoming a victim of that. So a massive, for lack of a better term, major theme would be anti-victim training. This entire thing is anti-victim training, because you want to make a conscious decision when you wake up in the morning to refuse to be the victim. And I'm not saying that you need to go out there and see who your adversary is, because if you walk around with a hammer, all you see is nails, as they say. So, and I'm going to come back to that. Actually, you know, that was the first thing I brought up at the camp. I said, you know, if you can remain objective and impartial and be open to anything, even some of the things that I'm going to talk about over the next few days that may be hard to hear in the beginning, you'll realize I'm that mate that will tell you what you need to hear, not what you necessarily want to hear. So I don't mean any offense by the things I say. I think it all comes down to intent. If I say, get fucked, you know, like this sort of thing, people are like, oh, Jesus, what's wrong with him, you know, sort of thing. But if it's like, oh, get fucked, you know, as I laugh, people go, ah, he's just joking, he's telling me to, you know, whatever. So it's, everything is open to interpretation, obviously. And, you know, as I talk about, we've got to be responsible for the way that we interpret and analyze things, you know what I mean? So coming back here, it's been a massive stress for the last couple of years, and just being unhappy and resentful for a lot of things, you know, a lot of it towards the situation, the restrictions, the mandates. I'm not saying I disagree with health measures or anything like this, or people getting, you know, the jab or anything like that. Each to their own. I couldn't care less what your preference is. I couldn't give a fucking. We're 2 years down the track, and right now, just the other day, as I shared on social media, but funnily enough, they blocked that. The New South Wales government, the health minister, was saying, if you haven't had the fourth one, you're crazy. And I just thought, I think everyone's thinking the opposite, bro, because even elderly people that were trying to tell me what to do with my fucking health up until now have said, I'm not fucking lining up again. I had two and I feel like absolute dog shit. And I was like, yeah, me too. I'm not going to comment on that, but I wasn't anti, I wasn't for. I think there's got to be some sort of responsible end to this, and the fact that they were fining us and locking us up and censoring us, and you know, we lost our freedom of movement, we lost our freedom of fucking speech, we lost our freedom of fucking choice, and I can't even leave if I want to, and that disgusts me. As I said before, I thought I grew up in a country that was pro freedom and pro choice and pro, you know, just when I say freedom of choice, it's believe what you fucking want. You know what I mean? If we, I've heard this analogy, I can't remember where, but if we both had cancer, which I've had a bunch of tumors taken out of my body since I was a kid, and that's why my head looks like Humpty fucking Dumpty, as I say to people, call me that, I don't give a fuck. I'll introduce myself as that in simulation training a lot of times to make people crack and laugh, because it's ridiculous. You know what I mean? It's about the most offensive shit I guess anyone could really say to me if they tried. I don't mind. I think, you know, one of the most important things is being thick-skinned and not taking yourself so fucking seriously, you know. So the only thing I'm serious about is gains and optimizing, you know, optimizing my skill set, my capabilities and my awareness. So anyway, back to what I was saying about coming back from Japan and being here and being stuck here and being resentful towards the whole situation, you know, and losing that freedom of movement and freedom of speech. You know, I'll try and share things on social media and they get blocked or they get restricted or it's whatever, or it's divisive, and I'm not trying to be. I'm just saying to people, like, hey, think for yourself here. You know, as I said, if we both had cancer, which was a point I was getting to, and I chose to sit here and blaze myself into oblivion with medicinal cannabis, as I often do, I've got a script for it, as I've said before, and someone else wants to go the chemotherapy route, who am I to say that they're stupid? Who am I to say that they're wrong or that it's a bad decision for them? You know, with all the conflicting information and all the fuckery that's going on, you still think that they work for us? You know what I mean? Like, seriously, like, we imagine if we were able to actually vote on how our taxes were used, because I'm fucking sick of paying this much. I'm sick of paying so much tax and so many, you know, just the cost of living and so many things that affect us on a personal level, that when I'm getting told by elected officials what I can and can't do, what I can and can't say, where I can and can't go, I'm like, what the fuck is going on here? And if I'm the only one to say it, then fine. I know a lot of people that called me fucking crazy in the beginning, and now they're saying the exact same thing two years later. As I said, elderly people that I met, say 6 months apart, at one time they're going, oh, have you got the vaccine, all this sort of thing. I said, look, I really don't want to talk about it. I think, you know, do you. And then 6 months later, they say, I'm not getting another one. I'm like, okay, well, fuck, again, you do you. I know other people that have said, you know, I know a lady that's a doctor, and she's like, we have to change everyone's mindset one bit at a time. We have to influence them. We have to tell them the truth. I'm like, let them find out for themselves, man. Fuck, we can't sit there and tell everyone that they're wrong and they need to agree with us. And just like this that I'm talking about now, I share things with people that I have to accept that it might be my approach, and it's up to them and them alone whether or not they're going to make the choice to take that on board, analyze that, adapt that, apply that to their own life. And you know, they're responsible. You guys are responsible for your own actions. You and you alone have to be able to live with the consequences of those actions once hopefully you consider them. We're going to get into that. But as I said, I can't just expect that everyone's going to be the same as me. I can't expect that everyone's going to accept the same realities that I do and or the same measures. When I say measures, there's three that I'm going to keep ranting about: preventative, counter, and response measures. Okay, before, during, and after times. And that's what we break down as risk, threat, and crisis. And I'm going to get into that a lot more. But again, just back to the point finally. Sorry about that for jumping around. But coming back from Japan and being stuck in Australia since the pandemic, because I've come back just before, you know, I have these expectations. It's like I'd probably spent more time in the States as an adult than Australia outside of Japan for a good period of time, right? So one thing that the States and Japan are known for is service. Service is number one. The customer is God, as they say. But when guys are working, or girls, whoever, are working for tips, you know, they really appreciate the work, and for one, and they take pride in it. And that's the sense of pride that I was talking about before, I think. It was hard to wrap my head around in the beginning, but, you know, you expect that someone's going to do their job properly. When I come back here, there's so many things that I talk about throughout this series about the reverse sort of culture shock coming back. And, you know, I walk into a coffee shop or wherever it is, and it's 10 to 5, and they, you know, do the baby head. They fucking roll their eyes like this. I'm like, what's going on? They're like, we close at 5. I'm like, I couldn't give two fucks. I just want a coffee. You know, like, and I get that way about me. Like, what the fuck are you telling me for? It sounds like a you problem. Like, you know, and that's often not a good way to approach things. But I do have an expectation where if I go into a shop, they've got their doors open, it says open, and they're selling shit that I want to buy, and they don't want to take my money, I think, what the fuck's wrong with you? Do you know what I mean? And okay, if I get overheated about it or have overly sensitive sort of feelings towards it or expectations or whatever, I'm the one with the problem, sure. But I've encountered that a lot. People want to be paid for their so-called time. Yet what are you, a fucking neurosurgeon, I always think? Like, you know, I walk into a supermarket and two ladies are standing there at the produce section. They're just chatting away and they sort of see me but don't acknowledge me and just keep chatting. I'm going, I'm really in a hurry. And I'm like, sorry, excuse me, do you mind just telling me where this is? And like, I'll just point and go, whatever, whatever. I'm like, holy fuck, man. You know, I get that you don't want to be there. I get that you're probably in a position or a place in your life that maybe you don't enjoy. But if you're there to do a fucking job, like, I've hired and fired a lot of people in my 5 companies across the 3 continents. And it doesn't, for me, it's never a, Oh, don't get me wrong. I've said and done a lot of fucked up things, but I thought they were deserving at the time. The point being is, if you're there to do a job, do your fucking job, you know, and you need reliable people. That's the hardest thing to find in business, reliable people. So I'm always pushing this self-reliance, you know what I mean? That's the biggest thing I've done. As you'll hear me talk about advisory for Japanese, not just government, but newspapers, and they asked me to talk about the sort of similarities or the, how can I say, the drawing the parallels between business and survival and fighting and all these things. And I think it's all the same. If you have an objective approach to things, you will have the clarity through the chaos to make the informed decision and the right decision, the appropriate decision that suits you and your purpose best. And that's what I'm trying to communicate in this. Again, I know I jump around a lot, and again, I apologize, but I've got so many different analogies and examples from all my time on the road and in the nightlife that I want to bring and share with you. And again, I'm overwhelmed with, I think love. It's weird to say, but it's all about love. You know what I mean? I love what I do. I love the people that I've met. I love the times that we had. And there's been some absolutely epic things going on. You know, we sat around a campfire the first night and everyone was singing. Like Jakey is a former, he's actually still a professional musician. He still does gigs, I believe, with his acoustic guitar. And he said, is there any song anyone wants to hear? And I said, Nothing Else Matters by Metallica. He ripped it out and he plays Upside Down. This motherfucker is nuts. I'm just going, Jesus. And then there's guys and girls sitting around singing this whole, and it's just, I got goosebumps thinking about it now. It's that alone and some of the games we played, because we all have situational awareness games, Jakey and I, from our collective, you know, over the years, you know, getting them from different people and developing them and what. And just the fun that we had with that was just so epic, just constant giggles and good times. And I learned a lot too. I learned from him, and he said that he's learned a lot from me as well. And it was just such an awesome time. And I wanted to get this before I go and get two or three wisdom teeth ripped out, whatever it is, because I probably won't be able to talk for a couple of days like last time. So I figured while I'm still on this high, and it's Friday now and I came back on Monday or Tuesday. It's been a few days, so I can feel that sort of dying down slightly. But I just had the best time. I'm still on that high, and I just wanted to share with you guys while I'm still on that sort of vibe. So yeah,
just wanted to give a quick shout out to members in the Street Smart Survival Academy who are on the Get Street Smart app. Please make sure you guys are up to date. So all you have to do is go to the app store and you'll see whether the button says update or download. If it says update, please make sure you click on update, as last week we added over 60 new videos. So that includes self-correcting checklists, follow-along workouts, step-by-step tutorials for self-protection, including both solo and partner drills, more grappling, more dirty boxing, more stick and knife work, and lectures covering the fundamentals of personal security, survival, and preparedness, along with much, much more, as you will see in the new ebooks, and even footage from recent events that we've had around Australia. Again, for members of the Street Smart Survival Academy, this comes at no extra cost. We just keep adding, we just keep optimizing. So I want to make sure that you get the best experience possible. So please go to your app store for me. Just make sure that it doesn't say update on the button. If it says update, make sure you press update and update it. Refresh, make sure your device is up to date, because every time we do an update and your device isn't up to date, you will see bugs or glitches. Same thing if your device is up to date and the app is not up to date. So please make sure that you are regularly updating that, you're staying up to date, and then all you got to do is refresh, click on learn, and you'll see all the new content there. We have emailed all 11,000 of you, and that includes our Japanese members, because we've added a lot of content in Japanese also, including a lot of our live sessions. And look, if you haven't yet joined us, this is the perfect time to do so. I'll leave the unlimited access deal up this week, where you can get three programs for less than the price of one. But my crew and I have invested 2 years of our lives into this, okay? We've refilmed, we've re-edited, we've reproduced so many things. It's such a higher quality. As I said, we're always about optimizing, and we want to bring you the best possible training experience where you can train anywhere, anytime, at your place, at your pace, with me in these guided follow-along step-by-step programs that are epic, and I'm so glad to be able to share them with you now. Again, now fully streaming in the Get Street Smart app, available on both Android and iOS devices. So I'll leave that information in the video description for you. You can check that out. You can cancel at any time. And if you don't absolutely love it, I'll give you a refund. That's how confident I am that this is the best decision and investment you'll ever make. But I'm sure you're going to be happily surprised either way when you see the epic deal I've left for you. So please check that out while you can. You can get started training with me in less than 2 minutes. As I said, anywhere, anytime, at your place, at your pace. See how to unlock unlimited access in the description, and we'll see you there.
So when it comes to the camp, there's so many highlights, there's so many awesome things that came out of that by way of realization, by way of friendships, by way of further developing bonds and relationships, especially between myself and Jake, who I've known him for 6 years. As the story goes, as some of you know, I was reaching out to him and I hadn't heard back from him yet, but that next day that I actually opened up something in the messages on one of our sites, I had a message from him. He was hitting me up about Tai Chi. He wanted to learn Tai Chi. He's a lifelong martial artist as well, and has done a lot of things and still is actually training BJJ now. I think he's just started with that in the last 6 months to a year or something. But he maintains that white belt mentality, as do I. And that's how I've trained so many different things and been able to go to so many different places, because I remain open. I remain open and as objective as I possibly can be. Many of you would have heard me share stories of my travels throughout Southeast Asia. And, you know, coming across the different masters or gurus or whatever and having to eat their shit first, you know what I mean, by them shitting on whatever I do and basically dismantling or breaking it down and saying, okay, do your move. And then I do something that I just did in whatever other style and they go, okay, stop. Okay, see here, I can do this, I can do this, I can do that. And I'm like, of course you can, because I'm fucking letting you. But again, that's me just being open to whatever they're going to say. It doesn't necessarily mean that I agree with a lot of the things that they said or did, but it doesn't matter at that point because I have to shut up and listen. Do you know what I mean? How do I know that I won't agree with something that's there? You know, so if I don't give myself the opportunity to listen and learn, then how the fuck will I know? You know, it's that overthinking of things. It's state that we find ourselves in a lot these days of constantly being distracted or thinking about, you know, not just the past, but especially the future. Oh, how am I going to use this? How am I going to use that? And having that uncertainty and being worried about that. I think that that's something that I constantly find myself practicing, being able to let go of in meditation, and also be aware of that I'm not getting anxious about anything else, about impacting factors from the past and or potential, you know, circumstances in the future. It's being in the now, so to speak. And that's really what meditation in one form, I guess, is to me. So, but, you know, I come across people in these sort of courses or events that are in that same mode. You know, I had one lady on the course that I feel horrible having to say this in front of other people, in front of everyone. But throughout the time, she'd sort of spoken up, and not just during my lectures, but also Jakey's, and it was clear that she just wasn't taking on board what was being said. Like Jakey said something, for example, going through and foraging, he was talking about collecting edible and medicinal plants, and gave some awesome examples. And she was just sitting there and not taking it in and sort of shaking her head and going, but I can't see myself going out and doing something like that. So what am I supposed to do? Just give up? Just do nothing, is it? And then you could see that she was just not opening herself up to these things. And we were playing personal security drills and scenario-based things, simulation drills and games and what. And there was one thing she couldn't see herself doing, and I said, fine, but at least give it a crack, you know, give it a go and see if it's something that you can use to your advantage, because you won't know unless you try. And she was just, I think it was a lack of confidence. I think it was her stress and her anxiety about a lot of things. And I really felt for her, because I know what it's like to overthink. You know, I'm a product of my environment too, and I often sit there and overthink about the potential risks and all these sort of things, hazards and threats, as we talk about. But, you know, as I said to these guys, what's possible and what's probable, think about what's possible and what's probable. You know, don't just think about all the things that could go wrong. Think about what you can fucking do about it. And I said something to that effect to her in the end, a lot nicer, obviously, but she needed to hear it. And I really hope that she wasn't embarrassed or felt shamed or singled out or anything like that, because I was just embarrassed saying it, because I don't want to be that guy that's like, you know, trying to shame somebody. So I'm always very considerate of that and very conscious of that, I'd like to say, because I really did feel for her. And I was like, look, I knew that she was leaving in probably half an hour to an hour or something, and she'd come back at me with something about, we'd covered some really basic preventative measures and some countermeasures, and she come out with something to the effect of like, but what if I'm like here and I'm in this corner and there's five guys here and then one of them starts to get like a, and she, I was like, that's very creative of you and you're doing well to think about scenarios, but you know, you could sit here and work yourself into a massive stress ball thinking about all the potential things that could go wrong or things that they could do to you. But I'm telling you, if you remain confident and capable, which you are, you've just showed me over the last 3 days that you're capable of doing these things. If you remain aware, you'll remain aware of your options. So we've talked so much about not just situational awareness, which is a massive buzzword that often is broken down in ways that's kind of like just, you know, look out for this, the scary man in the dark alley type bullshit. It's a very blanket sort of statement or approach, and often just sort of Band-Aid type fixes for cancers, things that will fester and metastasize and fuck you up in a slow and painful way because you're not addressing the problem. So anyway, I was just saying to her, look, remember your options. You know, if you understand your objective, your priority and your options, your priorities and your options, and we'd been talking about the cause, impact and effects of things. So, you know, just remember those things. Remember your options. You know, at other times throughout those 3 days, she was so empowered and she's like, fuck yeah. And she was there for her kids and she was there to be more confident and capable. And again, I'm sorry to use her as an example, but my whole point was to empower her. I didn't want anyone leaving our event feeling like they weren't confident in something that they'd learnt or not feeling more confident and capable. That was the whole point of this shit, you know? And she just agreed. She's just nodding like, yeah, well, fuck yeah, like kind of thing. And I was so happy that she'd said that. And I've had such amazing responses again from people in by way of appreciation, respect and gratitude. And I'm just reciprocating that. I appreciate so much the lady that I'm referring to being there and her friends and everyone else that was there. I learned just as much from them as they did me, I'm sure. And I can say that with absolute conviction and honesty because it changed my perspective. Again, one of the first things I talked about being entitled and not sort of expecting things, because if you have massive expectations from a sense of entitlement, that's how we get resentful towards people. I said, I'm resentful as fuck for being here for so long without being able to have that freedom of movement and being able to leave and go home and get my fucking clothes that are left in Japan or my office and all my shit that's still there, my friends, my family, everyone that I was used to being around, my surroundings. And I was very happy to be back here in Australia. It's such a beautiful place, although you can hear it's absolutely pissing down right now. We're dealing with some extreme weather and extreme circumstances in extreme times. But, you know, what are we going to do? Well, I think the only realistic and practical option for us is to remain calm and have that clarity through the chaos so that we can remain aware of, fuck, I mean, our priorities here. Like, what the fuck are we trying to do? What's our objective? You know, and I keep coming back to that. If we're going to remain objective, we remain aware of our objective, you know? So, as I said, a lot of the things that I brought up over the weekend, a lot of people were very responsive to it. Sounded like they were sharing a fucking brain, you know, like they were just like, fuck yeah, that's exactly it. But the way that I broke it down and looked at how you can be an asset or a liability and sort of gauge what you have and what you've got to work with and identifying capability gaps and or awareness gaps and filling those gaps by way of many, many tools. One of the really important things that I share and I talk about in this series as well is mental rehearsal training, that MRT or image training as we refer to it in Japan a lot of the time. It's just walking through those scenarios in your head and, okay, if this is going to happen, what's that potential trajectory? Where are things going to go from there and what are my options then? Do you know what I mean? Have I put myself in a position of disadvantage or advantage when my objective is always to gain and maintain the position of advantage? And what the fuck am I doing? You know, so it's catching yourself, and that's active meditation. So passive meditation is, like we say, we do it on the mats. I'm doing it, did it this morning. I did it about an hour ago, fucking stretching and doing a bit of Pilates and working out and just readjusting myself. I didn't have a lot of time to get a full one in, but you know what? It's better than nothing. And the fact that I'm sitting here in the rain and I've got about fucking 20 minutes till I got to be on the road, I could sit here and think of 10 reasons why I shouldn't have done this today or why I shouldn't, couldn't, wouldn't, hadn't of whatever. But I tell you what, I've got 100 reasons why I fucking should. One being the factor of if not now, then when, as you'll hear me say to Phil. And that was weeks ago that we had that conversation that you're about to hear, weeks ago. But I wasn't in a place that I was really happy with, and I was starting to have too much just negative vibes, and I needed to readjust that and reset that, hit that reset button. As I said, I was away for that 4 days and then another day, so 5 days all up in the bush. Didn't check social media once while I was away with Jakey. I don't remember sitting there scrolling or doing any of that sort of thing. And I think we're all guilty of it. So why not identify my sort of things that I need to work on first? And that was a massive one. Another thing is being entitled, having expectations of people, because the only one that you can have expectations of is yourself. Do you know what I mean? Like, I was just seeing the negative side in people, the overly sensitive, overreactive, bitchy side, the incompetent side, do you know what I mean? People's inability to communicate. Every time I'm going to get a coffee somewhere, like if I'm in a drive-thru, I have to repeat myself 6 fucking times. And, you know, my daughter and I are sitting there giggling at it going, like, how much clearer can I make it? You know, I'll say my order real slow and they just can't get it. And I'm just going, fuck. And on the road, you know, there's every day, I was just talking to Benny and DJ about this. Every time I'm on the road, someone is either right up my ass, riding right up to far too close, and or not putting their indicator on or not looking when they pull out, or on their phone and weaving. And it just does my head in. But I can either look at it like that, as in terms of, look, everyone's fucking useless and there's window licking mouth breathers all around me, or I can treat it like one of my other friends did, like when we were in Japan. I said, you know, not many people are paying attention. He goes, well, I treat it like a game. I'm on my bike flying down the fucking footpath and I know that people are just unaware. So I've got to dodge, duck and weave and make my way around without, you know, smashing into someone. I said, that's a fucking good approach, you know. So it comes back to, what can you do about it? And again, I make the analogy of running martial arts schools for the last 21 years. I started teaching in 2001, so yeah, as an assistant, as you'll hear me say. But yeah, I've been teaching for 21 years, and you see all sorts of people come through. You see that martial arts can definitely breed a sense of ego and can feed into that. But also, there's a lot of people, like, similarly to the ones that I've worked doors with, who are on the roids and on the coke and all sorts of things. And they've just got this massive, massive sense of insecurity, just insecurity issues. And that's why they swell up and, you know, run their mouth and do things. And don't get me wrong, I've definitely been there in terms of being, fuck, territorial and all the rest that comes with the nightlife. That's just something I'm not proud of, obviously. That's taught me a lot of great lessons, because we need to make those mistakes to have these lessons, these profound lessons and realizations that make you realize, like, fuck, get your shit together, you know, at least pretend to start being an adult, or, you know, living like an adult with some sort of sense of forward thinking and responsibility and accountability and objectivity, like just being objective about things, you know. I think objectivity is a word, might have made it up, but apparently all words are made up and everything is hearsay, isn't it? So there you go. Again, I just can't say how appreciative I was. And this whole thing reminded me of who I was. And again, on the way home with my daughter, just saying, I can't explain how grateful I am and how lucky I feel. And she said to me, I'm lucky to have you. I also realized that I'm lucky to have you as a dad. And I was just like, you know, and that was one of the compliments that, as soon as it came, I realized I need to take that, and I need to lean into that, and I need to use that as motivation, because until now I've used all the tall poppy syndrome around me, all the hate and the negativity and the telling me that I'll never be worth it, or I'll never be good enough, or I'll never make something of myself, or whatever it was, especially people closest to you sort of projecting their own insecurities and fears on you to tell you that, you know, just to basically cut you down when you're getting too tall for them. That's happened so much, especially over the last 10 to 15 years. The fact that I lived away for so long, I'd come back here and people don't want to hear where I've been or what I've done or what I do. They just want to bitch and fucking repeat hearsay or gossip, and, you know, they'd rather a negative story about who's broken up lately rather than what I've done, you know what I mean? People will talk about someone that's from a place like Canada, for example. I've been there a couple of times a year for a few years, and I've spent a lot of time there and I loved it. I love my friends and the nature and all those things. I don't love what's going on now. I feel for them. But yeah, I could sit there and share a lot of stories, but no one was interested, you know. So I thought, sweet, cool, whatever. I'm just back here to do what I do, see one of my mentors, see the nature, you know, expose my daughter to the lifestyle here in Australia, and hopefully she can get some sort of positive influence from that. But for a long time, I wasn't seeing that positive influence, so I was or that positive side to it. So I was more than happy to stay the fuck away, you know. But now being stuck here, it comes back to a point of having to accept and understand the fact that I'm here and I have to deal with it. You know, this, it's a matter of priorities. As I say to the girl all the time, it's not what you want to do, it's what you got to do. And I was also talking about things like, because people are asking me about parenting and just my opinion on some things. And I said, saying no and meaning it is a great thing. You know, having them hear things that they don't want to hear is a great thing. We joke around at home a lot. The girls and I, you know, call each other names and joke around a lot and just very straight with each other. You know, I think it's really important to have those straight conversations and not being rude or offensive or anything like that, but it's just saying, you know, just telling it like it is. And I'll give some examples another time that, you know, I feel aren't too personal. But, yeah, basically it's just it's having them thick skin and saying no when they need to hear no and having them being able to deal with that, because a lot of people can't these days. And, again, I was at that point where I couldn't deal with things, so I had to accept the situation, see the good in it, the yin-yang. You know, there's positive in all negative situations. And again, seeing this was definitely a side of that. And, again, it reignited something in me, this flame, this spark, this fire, this burn of this desire to be more is heavily attached to my personality, I think. You know, not just being bigger than I am, but always striving to achieve more than what I have. It's not about living outside or above my means by any means, but it's more of a just wanting to feel that forward sense of momentum, that progression, that optimization. I love it. I love sharpening, as I say. And we should be like the weapon ourselves. You know, a dull blade is more danger to you than anyone else. And so, it's just like putting a firearm in someone's hands that's untrained, uneducated, incapable, unaware. They're more of a liability to themselves and people around them than it ever would be a tool of self-protection, for example. So, you know, I relate that back to the mind a lot. And, you know, we need to stay sharp to stay safe. That's what it comes down to. We need to stay sharp to stay safe. And, you know, I'd worn this necklace on my neck for a long time, of Kunlun Sama, or Guan Yin, as they call it in Thailand, or Kuan Yin in Chinese, that I got in Thailand. And that's the goddess of mercy. That's what the Dalai Lama is said to be the reincarnation of. I'm looking at a couple of books here I got from one of the local temples here in Australia. Just simple things here that I've got all around me. I've got all these things, and that's great. I've got statues and ornaments and bracelets and tattoos and all these things. But if I'm, fuck, they're supposed to remind me of what I stand for. They're supposed to remind me of my beliefs. They're supposed to remind me to be a decent person, you know, to consider my thoughts, my speech and my action and my interactions and how I'm affecting others. You know, what can I do about a situation? If a situation's fucked, well, what can you do about it? And the real power comes through that clarity. They say wisdom, but that's what this is all about. This is a present that Jeremy from Real Combat Brisbane actually gave to me at our last Silat catch-up or gathering here on the Sunshine Coast. And it's the coolest present I've got in ages. And I'd been thinking to myself, it's a necklace for those who can't see. It's like a pendant or a mamori, what we'd call like a protection charm, I guess, on the end of a thick silver necklace around my neck. And it sits perfectly just below my chest, so it's not going to be bumped or smashed or cracked or whatever like a few others have, especially when the girls are shoving me, because we do a lot of wrestling games and creep up on each other and do all sorts of shit. But anyway, this one's flat, sort of some sort of steel, might be silver, I don't know. But the point is, the Fudomyo is the deity or the god, the ancestor that I have tattooed on my left arm. And for me, it's always meant a sense of power through wisdom, and wisdom through clarity and experience, obviously, but having the clarity, the calmness, the consciousness to be able to reflect on everything, past, present, and I guess future if you want, but just remember that now's the only time we can do something about it, you know. So the real strength comes through clarity, as I'd like to say, and I get that from being in that reflective state, that self-aware state. So I switched up the necklace a couple of nights ago, I guess it was, when I came back. Just gonna put that away, and said, right, it's time for a positive change. I'd been trying to be more empathetic towards people and sort of understand where people are coming from. And you'll hear us talk about it a lot, you know, hurt people. So whoever I'm dealing with, if they're a difficult person, they're probably just going through difficulty, as we say. But you tend to forget that in the heat of the moment, and you tend to get stressed or frustrated or anxious or whatever, because you have expectations of people. And I'm definitely trying to, you know, be better at that, just being more patient and calm and tolerant and just considerate. And I can preach it as much as I want, but I need to practice it more. I am, for generally speaking, I think not too bad at it, but there's times where you get frustrated, stressed, tired, hangry, you know, and you are not operating at your optimal sort of self on a mental, physical, emotional, as in spiritual, if you want to call it that, way or you know, being. So, you know, this Fedor mule, to have this around my neck now, really, it just reminds me that, you know, there's nothing wrong with being masculine. There's nothing wrong with being who I am and what I am, and that fucking hustler that just refuses to give in or give up. And it reminds me of that. But it also reminds me that, you know, the sword that's got flames coming off it is not to go out and impose your will on others or be offensive in any regard whatsoever. It's more about reminding myself that I will have the power to cut through the bullshit of life if I have that clarity. And the only way I'll have that clarity is by having that calmness and to have that constant reflection on myself. And again, catching myself in the act of being too, I don't know, anxious or stressed or heated, and realizing, fuck, you know what? As I've realized since coming back from that camp and having those profound realizations, is less is more. And that's what we preach in Tai Chi. I've been doing Tai Chi since the late 90s, as you'll hear me talk about. The things that I get from that practice of the reflection of the Taoist beliefs, which is now Shinto in Japan, and that's what most of my ink is, it's all a reflection of the philosophies. The nothingness is being impartial to things. That comes before Tai Chi or Yin Yang, which is that balanced, you know, the positive and the negative and the negative and the positive and the continuous flow of things and being one with that flow and all the rest, one with the Tao, one with the way. I can sit there and preach it all I want, but if I'm not practicing it, what fucking good is it? I always say that if you don't mean what you say and say what you mean, then what good are you? You're not worth your word to me, you know. But I've got to keep myself in check and go, well, fuck, man, are you staying true to your own objectives here? Are you wasting time with the distractions? Are you even just being frustrated with cunts that you're not going to even fucking see again? What's it matter? You know, so again, my approach is trying to remain as objective as I possibly can, as calm as I possibly can, so I can remain aware of my objectives, priorities, options, and just be adaptable. You know, if I'm not in that flow state, how the fuck am I going to be adaptable to anything? I won't be able to read the situation. I won't be able to read myself. I won't be able to read how I'm being interpreted. And so again, this change going from Kannon Sama to Fudomyo, from the female compassionate deity to the one of strength, that yes, to some people will represent you know, strength and some sort of god of, you know, I don't want to say war, because it can be interpreted in many different ways. I don't believe that many people look at it as that. There's another one on my arm that I'll go into later on for that. But this one, the point that I'm making is what it means to me is that strength comes through clarity. That strength comes through being aware of your own capabilities and being able to fill those capability gaps whilst remaining confident, because you're always on that grind. You're always sharpening. Again, you are the weapon, as fucking corny as that sounds, I know. We have to stay sharp and we have to look at ourselves, in my opinion, like a sword or like a blade. I have to be one solid structure from one end to the other. I have to be balanced. I have to be smooth where I need to be. And I have to be fucking sharp at all times. Otherwise, I'm just a liability to myself and those around me. You know, so for those of you here who are looking to optimize your skill sets, become more confident, become more capable, and to be a security asset to yourself and your loved ones, your household, please share this with someone who you think would want to hear something like this, or who you think this would resonate with, or someone who you think needs to fucking hear it, you know, someone who's maybe lacking confidence, someone who's maybe lost in terms of what to do for their own personal security, self-protection and self-reliance. Because, you know, you got guys that'll teach self-defense and martial arts and everything, and that's all good and well, but we don't have the luxury of fucking scratching our ass in the situation and thinking about, you know, what we could do here, or trying to remember a 27-step fucking wrist lock. As I say to people, if you're not in security or law enforcement, what business have you got of trying to restrain someone? You should be trying to not entangle yourself with a jiu-jitsu like we do. I'm a catch wrestler as well. I love it. I got my blue belt under Eric Paulson and for BJJ, And I still love it as a sport, but everything has its place. And as you'll hear Phil break down his experience in BJJ and martial arts, he's been a black belt in BJJ for over a decade now. He'll even tell you why he still trains with us and why he did from the beginning, because all those situations, those scenarios that are covered in martial arts aren't, we don't see them outside in the street, so to speak, and they're not covering things that are, that you are more likely to encounter on the street. For example, the conversational side of things. Everything starts with even just a look. Well, that point of that interaction, how am I managing this? You know, how am I managing my personal space? Do I want to pull them into my guard, or do I want to work from there? How about being able to talk someone down? How about being able to find common ground? How about being able to be aware of the trajectory and not bring the fight to someone who's not even trying to fucking fight you? You know what I mean? Some guys aren't actually trying to physically fight you, and you'll see these self-defense gurus say, punch him in the throat and kick him in the nuts and slam their head in the ground and stomp on it and all this sort of thing. And that's, okay, is that reasonable, necessary, justifiable? Can you articulate that? Is it going to be lawful? Fuck no. You know, it's just, again, an overreaction. And people look at my shit, especially in the martial side of things, the self-perfection side of things, which I'll get onto with Silat, and go, oh, fuck, that's overkill. And I say, yeah, because you don't know where you're going to have to go. You don't know how far you're going to have to go in terms of things. You don't know what the situation's going to require, how far they're going to fucking take it, what level of intensity you're going to have to come out with. Again, if you want to control a situation, you have to be able to control yourself first, right? So how are you going to have any sort of chance at controlling the situation, let alone someone else, if you can't control yourself? And that's what this all comes back to. So again, if you think that anyone is sort of lost in terms of what they should do when it comes to training for their own personal security, self-protection and self-reliance, if they're interested in martial arts but they don't know where to start, for example, send them here, share this with them, because we've got so many things that we're going to go over that will help create, develop and maintain those positive habits, functional skills and heightened sense of awareness. So again, thank you for joining us. Welcome, and let's get into it.
If you haven't yet joined the Street Smart Survival Academy, you can get unlimited access now in the Get Street Smart app, available on both Android and iOS devices. Get unlimited access to all of our follow-along step-by-step programs where you can train with me at your place, at your pace. And as you'll see, if you don't absolutely love it, I'll give you a refund. That's how confident I am that you will love it. So don't put off today what you're going to regret not doing tomorrow. Invest in yourself as the security asset and the backbone of your household. Join me to create, develop and maintain positive habits, functional skills and a heightened sense of awareness so that you can stay sharp and stay safe.